This is Make Me, Not Me. Product stories as sales driver and identity builder. Written by Ingemar Fredriksson and read by Richard Kemp. Introduction.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. John 1, King James Version.
What a small office, came the reply to the photo I'd sent to my cohabitant from my mobile. I'd been in Asia on business and was now on the way home. She knew this much already, but not that I'd boarded the plane home by way of London. The photo was not of an office, rather it was my first-class British Airways seat. That's where I started writing this book. The why had to do with the business trip I'd just made for a company where I'd recently become chairman of the board. The trip included meetings with customers in Japan, where we took the opportunity to visit Akihabara, the Tokyo district known for the huge assortment of electronics you can find. Strolling through the stores, I realized how incredibly difficult differentiating these products was among the massive varieties available today. Moreover, the Akihabara district is also known as the origin of the cosplay, costume play related maid cafes. Cosplay involves dressing in character costumes and is highly popular in Japan, especially when taking on known characters from comics, manga, cartoon films, anime, or computer games. The maid character involves young women dressing up in typically French-inspired maid's clothing. Guests at a maid cafe are treated like they've returned to their private home with the greeting, "Welcome home, Master Mistress, My Lord Lady," to then receive submissive service from the maid. As such, this involves making the guest feel like the lord or lady of the manor. When we were later interviewed by Japanese journalists about our products, my earlier thoughts coalesced around the importance of having really good product stories in today's market. This became clear to me as the lead interviewer insistently fished for stories of how and why we had developed the new products that we had traveled all this way to launch. Unprepared for this type of question, we improvised our way through, succeeding well enough to get a highly positive article in their industry publication. Mostly, though, it was the product's quality that sold itself, later winning several prestigious awards. But still, our PR work would have been that much better if we'd prepared our product story properly. After settling into that unnecessarily spacious and luxurious airline seat, the necessity of good stories finally dawned completely on me. I'm the first to acknowledge I'm not especially accustomed to travelling first class when flying, so I felt more like a visitor to the palace than its rightful owner. Still, I fully enjoyed my circumstances with the polite service and excellent food and drink. It felt like a somewhat more sophisticated variant of the treatment you might get at a maid cafe in Akihabara. This is the kind of situation where I often remember a line by Astrid Lindgren in her movie Rasmus and the Vagabond. The crook had found a cash box full of money, and as he opened it, fingering the bills, he cries out in his excitement, "Finally, I can begin to live like the gentleman I am." After a glass of vintage champagne, which I wasn't even aware existed despite my enjoying the good life, I fully understood the importance of products and services being able to make any of us someone more than who we are. That's because no matter how successful we become, we often have another person inside. In my case, it is always fragments of a small, fatso schoolboy bullied for a few years who was now wearing a suit. And unfortunately, no quality, brand, or price for this clothing can hide this little boy completely. At best, it offers some armor against the past. Products can also protect against the insecurity many successful people speak of when they wonder aloud about when others will understand they aren't that special, regardless what they achieved. I'd been thinking about product stories for quite a while, but it was on this trip when things fell into place, with the insight that this will become an important competitive weapon in future. If I worked in the United States, I'd likely have loudly bragged that this is the future of advertising, or that this is the only book you'll ever need to improve sales or margins or customer satisfaction. But I don't, and as a Swede, I'm satisfied with claiming that the ability to tell really good stories about your products is an incredibly cost-efficient way to improve your sales or margins or customer satisfaction. And it is also likely the future of advertising. This book is presented in six sections, where I start by describing the human aspect of why product stories have become so important because of changes to our circumstances and needs in our modern world. Next, I go through the communicative aspects of this, that is, why it has become more difficult to reach out to people as the volume of information continues to grow. I conclude this section with a description of how the structure of our brains can contribute to bridging these difficulties. In the third section, I explain why traditional advertising no longer works. And the fourth section is about stories and how you create them using a model from fiction writing that has four cornerstones. The fifth section describes the five things you can use to sell a story. And the concluding sixth section provides a simple model for how to go about creating a product story. Be sure, too, the product can naturally be a service. This book also relates quite a few stories about several products, but these are certainly not presented as perfect examples for how companies have used product stories in their communications. I provide these examples simply to show how many interesting stories there are behind the products we see every day. I hope this can inspire you to see your own products in a new light and help find ways to build product stories for these as well. Chapter 1. Make Me, Not Me. Well-known Swedish writer Stig Dagerman had an excellent book of poetry and essays published posthumously entitled Our Need for Solace is Insatiable. We also seem to have an insatiable need to be someone other than who we are, a phenomenon expressed in many ways. One of the most obvious is when we buy expensive branded products to chase prestige and status. This was previously an easy way to create an identity for yourself, but won't work much longer, largely due to how pyramids function, which I'll get to soon. But people don't just chase status to gain solace or create an identity for themselves. Most people, and perhaps all of us, are dissatisfied with themselves in some way. We want to be more than we actually are: funnier, smarter, prettier, thinner, stronger, more vital, cheerier, richer, sexier, nicer, more pleasant, more interesting, and all. Our sense of inadequacy is continually reinforced by advertisements that feed us images of people living the perfect life. And we imagine this perfection can be achieved by buying the products or services advertised. This constant exposure to people who are happy, in love, appreciated, successful, physically fit, and all else only contributes to reinforcing our desire to be someone other than who we are. Communicating such an all-encompassing ideal life becomes even more effective in creating a sense of inadequacy where people increasingly feel they deserve more. Product stories, therefore, function as either sales drivers and identity builders, or simply as a way to make our lives a little more exciting. The title of this book and the chapter you're reading comes from a dialogue in the animated film Kung Fu Panda. The storyline centers around the panda named Po, who works for his adopted father, a goose running a restaurant. For various reasons, Po becomes seen as the chosen one, the prophesied dragon warrior. This prophecy comes from an ancient legend predicting the coming of a master to the champion, the evil snow leopard Tai Lung. Tai Lung is the muscular, highly trained villain opposed to the less fit panda. Po better matches the stereotype often used in films for overweight people, lazy and liking food. Despite this, the old master Shifu accepts Po as a student to try and train him. Then, in a moment of despair, Poe expresses to Shifu his sense of futility in his effort and that he doesn't believe he really is the chosen one. Shifu then asks why Poe has stayed on as his student, to which Poe exclaims indignantly, "I stayed because I thought if anyone could change me, could make me, not me, it was you, the greatest kung fu teacher in all of China." So Poe has desires to be someone other than himself, which I believe is likely something he shares with many of us, and we only need to find someone, our Shifu, who can help us. Or perhaps something, like products that help us build our identity through their stories. Good product stories gratefully contribute to making me someone more than myself. To some extent, you can see this as a chance to buy content for your life. This may sound somewhat calculated, but when done with good intention, this can be a way to satisfy a human need by adding a little more content to people's lives or simply making things slightly more exciting or interesting. The market economy is, indeed, all about meeting the demands of the market. Stories beat facts. A writer who early emphasized the importance of storytelling in what he called the Dream Society is Rolf Jensen from Copenhagen Institute for Future Studies. His article with this heading was published in the Futurist Journal in 1996, where he made the claim that the huge increase in material wealth owes much to science and technology, but in the future, attention will turn away from science towards non-materialistic and non-scientific values. The highest paid person in the first half of the next century will be the storyteller. The value of products will depend on the story they tell. This might sound reassuring to everyone with writing ambitions and for journalists in today's media industry as it undergoes wide-ranging changes. Jensen also wrote, "Just as information manipulation is a valued skill in so many occupations today, storytelling will be a key skill in a wide range of professions, from advertiser to teacher, to business entrepreneur, to politician, to religious leader, even to futurists. Each will be valued for his or her ability to produce dreams for public consumption." Jensen also mentions two trends that are driving this development. One is automation and robotization of greater numbers of tasks so that fewer people are needed for work they previously performed. The second important trend is commercialization of emotions, where he emphasizes it will no longer be enough to produce a useful product. A story or legend must be built into it. Jensen concludes his article by painting a scenario of how things will be in his dream society for 2020. In this, he has chickens, pigs, cows, and horses ranging freely, and they will have a decent animal life, as recommended by animal rights activists. This article in The Futurist was expanded to become a book published with the same title in 2001. He's followed with updated versions, the latest with an introduction from 2013, in which he claims that some of his predictions have already been confirmed. One example he gives is that free-range eggs represent 50% of the market in Denmark and that consumers are prepared to pay 15 to 20% more for these eggs. He also claims that this willingness to pay more is due to these consumers preferring the story behind the product, that these hens were not forced to live in small cages and instead are raised the same way that our grandparents raised them. He invokes this as a classic example of the logic behind the Dream Society. Both kinds of eggs are similar in quality, but consumers prefer the eggs with the better story. In this specific case, Jensen is more correct than he can guess, since most consumers unconsciously relate free-range chickens to an image that doesn't quite match reality. He notes himself that these chickens have not needed to live in small confined cages, but instead are produced under the technology and methods of our grandparents. This is likely the image that most all consumers evoke when they think of free-range hens who are able to range outside in grass-covered yards. But they don't necessarily take advantage of this opportunity, as noted by the Swedish animal rights group, Djurens Rätt, Animals' Rights, which estimated that only half of these hens actually venture out into the fresh air. Organic hens are also required to have access to roughage, like hay or root and tuber vegetables, which stimulates their activity as well as provides nourishment. But it isn't likely this is how our free-range hens were raised, since even in Sweden, only about 13% of the laying flock are classed as organic. The majority, some 65%, are free to range only indoors, barn roaming, where tens of thousands of hens are raised in the same barn, and the remaining number are in enriched cages, 21%, or free range outdoors, 1%. Throughout the EU, holding hens in enriched cages is much more common, 57%, and barn roaming is next at 27%, then free range outdoors, 12%, and finally organic, 4%. One practical reason for why Sweden has a smaller percentage of their laying flock outdoors is the climate. That is, the weather is simply too cold for laying hens to be outdoors much of the year. Denmark, which Jensen discusses, has approximately half their egg production from hens in enriched cages, while the rest come from barn roaming, organic, and free-range outdoors. So, it is indeed true that approximately 50% of Danish eggs are produced by hens that can be categorised as free-range hens, but it is not correct that they were raised in the old-fashioned, romantic circumstances he describes. But does it matter? Isn't the most important consideration that the hens are free? Yes, at least according to many animal rights activists, like the Swedish Djurens Rätt Association. Still, they are against all forms of egg production, stating on their website that hens' eggs are, just like all other bird eggs, the beginning of chicks, and Djurens Rätt contends that they belong in the birds' nests and nowhere else. We are therefore against all egg production. The additional criticism against holding laying hens in enriched cages is that this environment is seen as providing insufficient space for the hens to behave naturally. They make the comparison that hens in these cages have the space of a letter-sized sheet of paper on which to move around. But another reason for criticizing keeping hens in cages is likely the easy target it provides. When you compare the concept of cage to free, it's hard to find advocates for having something that hasn't done anything in a cage. This, and the comparison to the letter-sized sheet of paper, are quite simply good stories to use in selling something, which in this case is advocacy of animal rights. This all sounds simple, but a look at the facts complicates the picture. Here, we implicitly believe it's better to be free than to be caged. But is this really true for hens? The primary reasons opponents to cage-laying hens use relates to the small space the hens live in, and that they can't behave naturally, mostly because they can't pick and scratch for food, which hens otherwise spend up to 61% of their waking time doing. If hens are not permitted this natural behaviour, say the opponents to cage hens, their well-being is affected negatively, which at first glance certainly seems logical. Applicable regulations for laying hens in the table below shows that caged hens have less area to move than free range. Requirements are max hens per square meter, organic outdoors 6, free range outdoors 9, barn roaming 9, enriched cages 13. Say these animal rights activists are correct in using the comparison of a letter-sized sheet of paper for cage hens to be on, then we see that the ecological, free-range, and barn roaming have 2 and 1.5 sheets to move on, respectively. How does this affect their well-being? Unfortunately, for organic and free-range, not very well. The fact is that mortality for free-range hens is nearly twice, 6 to 8%, that of those in enriched cages, 3 to 5%. Several reasons are given for this. Hens cannot maintain any kind of hierarchy within large flocks. Serious feather pecking and deaths due to cannibalism among large flocks is more frequent. This is because feather pecking or cannibalistic hens can attack more other birds than when they are caged. When this study was conducted, there were no figures for organic hens, but these generally have similar conditions to barn-roaming hens with the additions mentioned above. Regarding general health, the report stated, "The health of hens in cages differs more between flocks kept in cages and free-range or organic flocks than the difference between organic and conventionally raised hens. This results from free-range and organic hens coming in contact with infectious agents in manure much more than cage-kept hens. With the large flock size in free-range and organic hens, where every individual hen can move freely within the same area, infectious agents can also more easily spread from hen to hen than it can occur in a barn with cages. Another problem with keeping barn-roaming hens is the air often becomes dustier than with cage hens. This arises from the hens moving more and walking on more litter spread in the hen house. This causes poor air quality, which includes high levels of ammonia. None of these studies can address the psychosocial health of the hens, if this was at all possible to study, and how this is affected by the different hen keeping methods. Moreover, this description does not take a position on which type of eggs are best, which we can all do for ourselves. Why I digress here is only to describe how a good, simple story can have a strong impact on consumer behaviour. One result of the argument for eggs from free-range hens instead of caged hens is the steadily declining demand for the latter. Jensen's example regarding eggs from free-range hens provides even stronger support than he intended for how important a good story can be. If the story is good enough, we will, at least to some extent, remember it regardless whether complicating facts speak against it. In this case, the story isn't untrue in any way, rather, it is the consumer who creates the conscious image of what free-range means. When it comes to the story generally, we see that Jensen's predictions have been fully confirmed. One of the hottest concepts within the business world in recent years is corporate storytelling. Stories that relate the origins of a company creating an identity that, in turn, makes the company's product or service offering more interesting. But now, it's high time to take the next step into product storytelling, where first I provide more reasons for it. The problem with pyramids. In many cases, the products we surround us with contribute to creating both group affinity and a personal identity, regardless whether it is a Palestinian kufiya scarf or a Louis Vuitton monogram scarf. This is especially rewarding as we all strive to be both individuals and members of one or more groups. But this endeavor becomes especially tangible and paradoxical for youth who always strive to be unique while at the same time being terrified of sticking out. Since we are herd animals, many of us try to gain the highest possible position in the group we want to belong to, and we generally seek out the most interesting groups. The group at the local bar that seems to have the most fun, the gang of schoolmates who seem coolest, the students at the university who seem the smartest, and so on. Our social desires drive many to prefer belonging to the highest levels, and expensive products are then a good way to show that we belong to the group, since we can afford to own the attributes that the group uses. This, while it provides an interesting identity, as implicitly understood, a successful, well-off person. The problem with pyramids is that the top will always be smaller than the middle and the bottom. As people achieve better economic status, more can afford buying the attributes used by those at the top. But the more who buy and use these attributes, the less unique they become, where their significance becomes more diluted. This could be seen as a collective diminishing marginal utility, as the more people who can afford a certain product, the less esteemed it becomes by the larger collective, since it diminishes their uniqueness. The relationship for status products is therefore the reverse of non-status products. The latter involves social proof, where the more people using a product makes it more attractive to others. In this situation, those who can actually afford to do so buy more expensive products to maintain their position at the top, to avoid becoming bobos. Human capacity to contrive expensive attributes that signify a position at the top never fails to surprise me, and includes everything from tulip bulbs to vehicle registration plates. In his book Tulipomania, Mike Dash describes how an enormous speculative bubble that burst in the Netherlands in the mid-1600s arose. Tulips were first imported from the Ottoman Empire to the Netherlands, starting in the 1500s during the Dutch Golden Age, when the Republic was formed and began colonial expansion. Tulips quickly became increasingly popular as a flower unlike any other that grew in these northern climes. The introduction of a unique product with limited supply to a market, where many had more money than they could spend, almost automatically meant prices would rise. And in this case, horticulturalists could cross tulip varieties to provide the market with increasingly spectacular new varieties of this colourful flower, while their supply was limited by smart or unscrupulous businessmen, causing prices to skyrocket uncontrollably. At the height of the hysteria for bulbs, the price for a single one equaled 10 years' wages for a skilled artisan. The rising prices resulted from buyers expecting to be able to find other buyers who were willing to pay ever higher prices. Tulipomania is therefore often cited as the first historic example of a speculative bubble, though actually many others had occurred earlier. This provided both a symbol of the havoc a speculative economy can cause and an example of the absurd prices people are willing to pay for products that can impart status for them. In modern times as well, we see examples of unfathomable prices when extreme wealth is combined with unique products. One example is vehicle registration plates that were sold for millions. The United Arab Emirates, UAE, was once a poor region in the 1950s. Pearl fisheries, an important income source from the early 1900s, had nearly been wiped out. Demand first declined after the First World War and further during the Great Depression of the 1930s. Supply also increased when Japan began to farm pearls based on a patent from 1916, and this production has increased steadily until today, when nearly all pearls sold are farmed. After the Second World War, newly independent India imposed severe import tariffs on pearls from the UAE. In combination, this caused the region to suffer significant economic difficulties. The British, who had supported the sheikhdoms under a treaty from 1892, therefore established a development office to help support growth in the area. This included conducting several exploratory oil wells, looking for reserves as already found in nearby countries. After several failures, oil was discovered off the Abu Dhabi coast in 1958, with production starting in 1962. These operations have increased greatly since, resulting in the country now having the seventh largest oil reserves in the world. Oil exports have brought the country so poor when in the United States the Doobie Brothers had a number one hit, All I Have to Do Is Dream, to being one of the richest in the world today. From their first president, Sheikh Zayed, the UAE has invested heavily in their citizens through schools, medical facilities, and infrastructure. But this doesn't prevent these citizens' individual aspirations for status and position, which can take rather absurd expression. At an auction held on February 17, 2008, the 25-year-old businessman Saeed Abdel Ghaffar Khoury won bidding for a vehicle registration plate for his car, number one, for 52.2 million dirham, over $15 million at the time. Despite this being the most expensive registration plate in the world at the time of writing, this buyer said afterwards that he was willing to pay twice as much. The reason he gave for this was simply that he and his family wanted to be number one, adding, who wouldn't? His family already had several expensive plates, as his cousin, Talal Ali Mohammed Khoury, who had bought numbers 5 and 7 for a total of another $10 million. These are placed on two of his Rolls Royces, the red one and the purple one, thus confirming a local practice, that those with a lot of money want more than just exclusive cars. Since many in the UAE can afford luxury autos, it has become popular to demonstrate that you really are someone by having the lowest possible registration plate. The attitude among the local population is that a car, regardless of how expensive it is, isn't worth much if it doesn't also have the right kind of registration plate. Here, though, a mitigating circumstance relating to such conspicuous consumption is that the proceeds from the auctions, where 90 registration plates were sold for a total of nearly 89 million dirham, went to the construction of a specialist hospital. And the owner to numbers 5 and 7 mentioned above also claimed he planned to keep his plates until he dies, but they should be sold again at auction, where he wants the proceeds to also go to charity. But his cousin, Saeed, doesn't seem to have the same philanthropic ambitions, stating he had no intention at all to do the same. He had only bought the registration plates with the number 1 because he wanted to and didn't care how much he had to pay for it. The status chasers, a steadily growing number, naturally want to remain at the top of the pyramid, which continually gets more difficult. While every status chaser can't afford to buy ridiculously expensive registration plates, they also see that more people are holding Gucci or Louis Vuitton bags. This can be either pirated copies or bought on payments through the myriad financing solutions available today for everyone who doesn't have the means, but would gladly appear as though they do. Salvation from this can come in one of two forms. First, buy a substitute product, like a bag by Michael Kors, cheaper than those mentioned above, and which you can justify by claiming real taste, and that you're distancing yourself from everyone who thinks they can be someone just by buying an expensive bag. Or you save yourself by acquiring more knowledge than other users. Still, either strategy involves attempting to build an identity with something more than a product attribute, which also becomes a necessary consequence of the problem with pyramids. Expensive branded products can still signal the social class we want to be part of, but they are no longer enough to create an identity. You no longer need to be successful or well off to possess apparently expensive attributes. These can be pirated copies or financed by no credit check text loans. Therefore, it has become increasingly important to define ourselves by something other than physical attributes. In practice, this means we can create our identity through our knowledge of the products we are passionate about. This can still be the Gucci bag, but for it to help build your identity, you not only have it with you at all times, you must also know something about it, the material it's made of, who else has a similar type, and much more. One consequence of the pyramid shape, therefore, is that knowledge becomes a base for self-actualization and identity building. This knowledge-based identity building starts at such low levels as knowing how to pronounce a word, from where it migrates to knowledge about the history, origin, content, and similar of products and services. We can call this phenomenon productless identity building and look at how it is expressed. Productless identity building. An example of productless identity building is this dialogue I picked up visiting a bar in Stockholm several years back. It's afternoon and I'm sitting with a cup of coffee reading background material for a meeting when a young man asks the bartender, "Do you have any nice juices?" "Well," answered the bartender, "we have apple and orange juice." "Really? Nothing else?" replies the customer, obviously disappointed, while leaning over the counter, trying to help with looking. The bartender looks around and soon finds another alternative from his drink mixers. "Here, we also have cranberry too," using the English word for the juice. "Oh, cranberry, you have cranberry, I'll take a glass of cranberry," exclaimed the customer, obviously elated, which I noted not only from his tone, but also by him managing to say the word cranberry in English 3 times in a single thought, instead of the Swedish word tranbär. It seemed he couldn't get enough of the flavour of that exotic word by pronouncing it over and over. Knowing how to correctly pronounce the names of various products is a common type of productless identity building. This is also possible because we have a partiality for accepting foreign names of products, even though these could easily be translated to the local language. This is likely largely due to a feeling that it sounds more exciting or cooler saying latte with bagel and lox than coffee with milk and salmon and bread. At this bar, tranbar in the local language doesn't sound as exciting as cranberry in English. To build our identity, we use more than simply our knowledge of the product. We may also use our knowledge about places, people, or how you do things correctly. The latter has contributed to a boom in TV programs in the educational TV genre. The programs have a presenter relating how to cook food, arrange flowers, build a porch, or even describing how different wines taste. Any of these topics can naturally be an interesting way to gain additional knowledge, but the genre tends to go too far when the show starts on children's crafts for adults, even if done under the heading of interior design. A common denominator for this type of TV programming is it often involves celebrities, or when the presenters started out unknown, they tend to become celebrities from being on the shows. Having been in a TV program often suffices for being designated a TV celebrity in the headlines whenever they do something ostentatious off the show. And celebrities have also created their own highly appreciated TV genre, which we can call celebrities laughing. TV viewing is flooded with this type of program, all of which seems to involve lots of celebrities laughing. To get them laughing, the show often involves their participation in some type of quiz or simple skills testing. These examples highlight an apparently insatiably popular desire for celebrities, so it isn't surprising that some people also build their identities through having extensive knowledge of the various preferences of these celebrities. The difference between this type of productless identity building and others is that knowledge of another real person also creates a kind of pseudo-relationship with them. Some of these people know more about their favourite celebrities than they do about their own aunts, and knowing so much about their celebrity feeds a sense of relationship with them too. If you want to be snide, you could say these celebrities make it possible for people to have pretend friends throughout their entire lives, and not only as children. But a more positive approach would allow that celebrities are the least common denominator in our urbanized and globalized world. That is, they create a link between us and others. This brings us back to our school days, where we experience a link between ourselves and our classmates, both teachers and the others. We have all surely experienced how easy it is to slide away from other people when these links disappear, as when you leave school, leave a job, or move to a new town. When you meet again after several years, you can quickly run out of discussion topics after going through a few of your common memories. We simply seem to have a need for human links between us and others, where we see, as above, that celebrities fill that role for many. That these celebrities have also become authorities and as such also influence our buying decisions is a topic we'll return to later in the chapter, Positive Reviews. I recently heard in a radio program one of the presenters admit to how embarrassingly influenced he was by everything that U2 lead singer Bono does. When Bono sold his Maserati for a BMW, the presenter immediately changed their preference for what car to have. Cars are the classic example of productless identity building, mostly among men. Cars and other technology products whose fans often devour technical descriptions. They can then rattle off technical terms like a real petrol head. What tech manufacturers can do to help all these tech nerds is to give them simple explanations for why various technical properties are better or more important than others, and preferably presented in new and interesting ways to enable retelling these facts as the unique personal knowledge of the teller supporting the customer's productless identity building. Everyone is unique. In his book, The Road to Character, 2015, author David Brooks describes under the heading, The Big Me, how attitudes have changed in relation to ourselves. This includes the following. When research firm Gallup asked students in 1950 if they felt they were very important, 12% responded yes. When the same question was asked in 2005, 80% of students of the day responded that they felt very important. Brooks also describes what is known as the narcissism test, where people can rate how much they agree with statements like, I like to be in the center, I like to be seen because I'm special, someone should write a biography about me. The median score on this test has risen by 30% over the last two decades. The greatest increase has been in the share of respondents who agree with the statements, I am an exceptional person, and I like to look at my body. Celebrity is also something that many more people strive for than previously. A 1976 survey on individual life goals ranked celebrity as number 15 of 16 possible alternatives. In 2007, 51% of the surveyed youth responded that celebrity was their primary goal in life. You can note here they didn't simply want to be well known, but that this was their primary goal in life. We also see that many youths are anxious to become famous in the huge numbers who apply to humiliate themselves in front of sensation-seeking TV viewers in docu-soap reality TV like Big Brother and Paradise Hotel. Here we see media reports that more people apply to appear on Paradise Hotel Sweden than to enter teaching degree programs, quite possibly related to educational level or, more likely, level of delusion. Another surprising aspect of these docu-soaps is that they and many music videos show no restraint in choosing participants to seemingly represent diversity in gender and ethnicity, but certainly not in relation to age, BMI, or appearance. The only exception to this would be the more handicapped humor variants of these reality shows, where an ordinary person can show themselves off by being naked or generally acting imbecilic. Common to all of these, though, is that entertainment value seems to override good taste and the politically correct, which can likely be interpreted as a signal that the viewing public accepts and supports these people's ambitions for celebrity, regardless of how they get it. This also provides evidence of how important entertainment value is in relation to other considerations in society, which again confirms the need for good product stories. A few years back, I personally faced the mild absurdity in this phenomenon when an acquaintance happily related that she'd gotten an invitation to a high school reunion class. The big attraction for this event was that Survivor Jane, fictitious name, would take part. Now, if this Jane had been in the same class, or perhaps at least the same school as the class having the reunion, you might find some logic or entertainment value, but she had no connection whatsoever. What's more, she had no qualifications as entertainer, not as singer, speaker, or comedian. Her only qualification as guest, which seemingly created great expectations, was having been in the TV show. You can run into other examples of the big me today in public environments where you encounter plenty of opportunity to listen to others' conversations, often on their phones. In many situations, you simply can't avoid hearing these conversations. And when you're getting to be a little cantankerous, like I am, you start wondering if the most common word in the language is I, as in, and then I said, hello, I said, you know, I said, I am. I would never, I always, I say what I think, I feel, and so on and so on. At times you get the feeling that some people can't speak a single sentence without the word I. But perhaps that's my cranky old mind being overly sensitive. Other examples of how the I amplifier is practiced in public include naturally selfies, where the individual is always in the foreground, and the changing function of the showcase window. That is, the windows are more often used now as mirrors for a quick check on your own appearance rather than to actually look at the products displayed. For a more positive approach to considering how a relative few seem prepared to do just about anything to achieve celebrity, you need only look at what they offer the public in doing so. Besides providing a diversion, the scenes we see played out in these reality dramas also provide fertile ground for discussions in schoolyards and workplaces about what was right or wrong. I think it's so terribly mean she, dot, dot, dot. I think she was absolutely right when, dot, dot, dot. He is so blatantly fake. Did you see how he, dot, dot, dot? And so on, which honestly is actually a modern variation of the moral discussions that in earlier days took place outside the church on Sundays. The consensus that arises out of these discussions and other debates we often read in the evening papers and on social media is often designated as politically correct. Something that many look down on because they are such simplified and obvious truths as all humans are equal. The lack of recognizing the complexities involved can naturally be provocative for many thoughtful people, but still, the modern politically correct rarely differs much from earlier dogmas. This is regardless whether these are religious or political, as there is hardly any real profoundness in concepts like thou shalt not steal or we are all equal. The dogmatic truths that arise from the politically correct are often used as different forms of productless identity building. Sharing views on forums, blogs, and other social media is a way to build an identity as someone who stands for feminism, equality, LGBTQ rights, animal rights, or multiculturalism. As in earlier times, with their religious and political truths, such argumentation often claims to take the higher moral position. By aggressively and clearly advocating the new dogmas, a rather innocent endeavor, people can build an identity that they are someone who really cares. If you're active enough or good at formulating yourself, this can eventually lead to a kind of micro-celebrity within a limited group of like-minded people. But many are idiots. Even if Maslow's hierarchy of needs lacks empirical support, it is a good description of human needs. But he unfortunately misses an important level that the ancient Greeks and Romans would have understood. We'll get right back to this, but if you aren't familiar with the theory, here is a brief run-through. Abraham Maslow was an American psychologist who theorized that human needs are organized in rational order, with the most basic at the bottom. The order of these needs is usually illustrated with a pyramid or steps, and the theory is therefore often referred to as a pyramid of needs or a set of stairs. The pyramid, from the bottom to the top, consists of psychological needs, safety needs, social needs, respect and appreciation, and self-actualization. Some have surely seen this illustration on the net, where some joker has put another layer at the bottom, writing Wi-Fi or Facebook as the most basic of needs. But it isn't that level that is missing and which I mention above, though these are the prerequisites for the missing layer. It would be easy to take this as indicating a naturally, nearly evolutionary desire for people to move up in the pyramid. When the needs on one level are satisfied, people strive to attain the next level and so on, seeking the highest level of self-actualization. The missing level, though, should be inserted between respect, appreciation, and self-actualization, suitably designated entertainment, because what does a large part of the world's population spend much of their recreational time doing? Certainly, many do self-actualize through exciting building projects, courses, or travel. But the greater portion of time not committed to the underlying needs levels in the pyramid is spent by most of us entertaining ourselves in various ways. Watching TV, playing games, surfing on the net, adding updates in social media, and so on. And, in many cases, social media also fills a function on the next lower level, that of validation. But Facebook and other similar sites are often used to share films, pictures, and stories. It is simply a platform for our digital relationship. That this intellectually destructive misuse does not cause the same outraged reactions as the violent movies of the 1970s did is likely mostly because nearly everyone is doing it. Several years ago, I led a government commission and I was able to have my teenage son do his student work introduction with me for a week. He had the opportunity to attend an expert committee meeting for the commission, which included representatives from several governmental agencies. The first observation he shared with me after the meeting at the Swedish government offices was about everyone who had been looking at their telephones during the meeting. Certainly not the best lesson in work ethics for this teenager's first meeting with the adult world, since children do as adults do, not as they say. Another reason why the excess consumption of entertainment does not cause outrage may also be its presence historically through the ages. The ancient Greeks already knew this and had a word for those who engaged in it: idiots. While this word has taken a different meaning in our times, it is certainly often used to denigrate people as being less gifted, and this often because they simply have a different opinion from our own. Still, the word idiot was first used in the Athenian democracy to describe a person who was selfish and acted only in their personal interest. The word originates in the Greek idios, which means one's own or private. The opposite was someone who engaged in the public interest in some way, such as being active in politics, for example, which was considered honourable. The Athenians felt that idiot was something you were born as, while citizen was something you became through education and involvement in societal activities. The Romans, too, were familiar with the paralysing powers of entertainment, which provided us with the satirical phrase panem et circenses, bread and circuses. This was coined by the poet Juvenal, who was a strong critic of the moral decay he saw in Rome of his time around 100 CE. What's more, Juvenal is also credited with the maxim mens sana in corpore sano, a sound, healthy mind in a sound, healthy body. With his phrase, bread and circuses, Juvenal meant that Roman leaders appease the masses through providing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.